So did Amazon manage to solidify its prowess when it comes to vertical integration, cloud and chip offering?
Well, they seem to be doing a really excellent job of that. And what's interesting about what Matt just said is they're going to let customer demand drive, you know, how they build out these different capabilities for AI applications, which tells us that there are going to be different models purposed to different types of workloads. So everybody's thinking, oh, NVIDIA is the market dominant player right now. They have massive market share. And they're treating it like it's one sort of big thing that's homogenous. And I think what people are going to realize over time is that there are going to be different types of models for different workloads, and different chips will be useful for developing such different models and for running those models, for doing the inference. So I think there's a lot of room for different chip players here, and we should expect more of the in-house chips, like what Amazon does in collaboration with Marvell, or what Google does in collaboration with Broadcom, to continue to rise in prominence as we've been seeing in the recent news coverage.
I mean, yeah, let's talk about Marvell. Out with earnings, out with also a key purchase of Celestial AI that's all about lasers, and we can talk into lasers a little bit more. But are we seeing ASICs really starting to put a concern towards NVIDIA? Should they be threatened by this custom-built model?
Well, no company likes any kind of competition, right? So I'm sure NVIDIA would just be happier if they didn't exist. But clearly, look, ASICs are very powerful. That stands for application-specific integrated circuit, right? So these, I believe, these kind of XPUs or TPUs are going to be designed and going to be put to use for the type of applications in AI for which they're best, you know, designed. So it's clearly the case that NVIDIA is going to lose share over time in the big world of AI compute. But nobody should be surprised by that. And the pie is still growing so massively, they can't meet demand. They're unlikely to be able to meet demand for some years to come. And so there's a lot of room for ASIC approaches to play roles in various types of models. So we should expect that.
Before we talk more lasers, I want to go back to where we sort of started, the fact that you're getting specific chips for specific applications, but also specific models. And I think there's some fret in the market today around Microsoft's other part of the flywheel, because everyone thinks Microsoft's got a very strong cloud offering, and clearly we've seen Azure not be able to fill demand with its supply. But we're now worried just basically about the applications, about companies being willing to pay more for these AI agents and actually the use of AI. What are you hearing in the market? How much does that impact your sector of chips?
There is a lot of sporadic, I should say, information about how much AI agents and AI is being used in different settings. So, right, there was a story today about how, you know, Microsoft has reduced its sales targets for getting AI agents, you know, to be adopted by their customers. And so that has people concerned. You know, Salesforce similarly is trying to roll out, right, their AI agent capabilities. And some people are wondering whether that's going to happen. But there are so many other applications in addition to those kind of smart helper AI agents. And I think the earlier in the week announcement with NVIDIA and Synopsys is a good example of that, right? The industrial uses, whether it's these digital twins, basically being able to model out a whole factory or a whole building or, you know, any other physical presence in simulation, you need this kind of computational power, you need AI. And so that kind of collaboration, I think, really points to lots of other applications for AI. And then you go to biotech and pharma and, you know, computation. We've just been held back for so many years by its limitations from the CPU side. And now that we have these GPU-based accelerators and innovations in fabric, like what Celestial is bringing to Marvell and what Broadcom already does, it is speeding up all of these computations, making far more applications possible across all industries.
And some would say limitations have been in the fabrication in the United States, energy, just making sure that we've got more solid and trustworthy supply chains. I think about just the news also earlier this week, $150 million stake in a chip startup by Pat Gelsinger. Of course, we all know him from Intel. But the U.S. is making that investment in Xlyte, a startup. Joanne, you have some real insight as to how this technology is being put forward. It's all about lithography, taking on ASML.
Yeah, so Xlyte is developing a new laser technology, and that is a fundamental ingredient to doing lithography, right? ASML being the leader in extreme ultraviolet lithography, which depends on these very high-end lasers. So Xlyte's taking a different approach to laser development. And what's interesting is, and also reminds me of my past, is that this $150 million investment by the federal government, by the CHIPS and Science Act, the work is going to be done at a place called Albany Nanotech, which is where I got my start in the semiconductor industry, you know, 20 plus years ago. And it's a location for collaborative R&D for development of new manufacturing techniques, development of new materials, development of new recipes for designing and building chips. And it's all the major players in the industry are there, and it's pre-competitive. And so for X-Lite and Pat Gelsinger to be doing it there with the support of the federal government sort of enhances this model of get some public support for a technology that can be spread and help the industry, broadly speaking, and does go towards this effort to enable more chip equipment design and manufacturing to eventually occur in the United States. It's going to take a long time. These programs, you know, as I was involved with back in the early 2000s, they take many years, but it's a great way for the U.S. to subsidize a general technology, which could ultimately help the U.S. position in equipment manufacturing.